Hey Denver, here's what's coming into view for April 2022. Bison are an important piece to the culture of tribal nations. Denver recently donated 33 bison to help restore herds on tribal lands.
To be able to be a part of reintroducing back herds to tribal lands is such a powerful moment, I think, for Denver.
Did you know we live in an urban forest? We talked to the city forester about what that means and how they maintain our trees.
It's definitely a challenging place to try to grow trees.
Plus, we walk the runway at Denver Fashion Week.
If you've never been to a Denver Fashion Week runway experience, expect to be excited because honestly, every single night is centered around a different theme because it's for everyone.
These stories and more are just ahead on the premiere episode of Elevating Denver.
When we think about fashion, typically people start to think about New York, Milan, Paris, London, right? So what does Denver have to offer? And I think that in order for those four cities, those big cities, to have new, fresh talent, they look to smaller markets and smaller demographics. So what we can offer is it's a platform for emerging talent that maybe just doesn't have that capability of being noticed in those larger cities, and we can give those emerging, you know, stars that time. I'm Haley Hoda. And I am the runway producer and director for Denver Fashion Week. Tonight actually is all about local couture. So we're gonna focus tonight on original pieces. So each individual piece, there's nothing else like it, right? That's what couture means, that there's one of a kind. So each segment is going to be very individual, all the way from, you know, somewhat wedding dresses, all the way down to, you know, corsets and things like that. So couture can really mean anything.
My name is Cora Aversano, and I'm the designer of Aversano Designs. I grew up in Lakewood. My parents still live in the same home that I grew up in, actually. So I started designing a year and a half ago. I have a love of like 60s movies, a little old school glam, I would say. So my first two gowns, the whole point of it was bold and beautiful, pretty much. The glamorous elegance of the 60s, like Hollywood 60s. So then I brought that into this new collection. The funniest thing that I do when I make dresses is I watch Golden Girls the whole time. Don't ask me why, that's just my go-to. But I feel like once I'm in it, it's just like you just keep going. So I feel like I can make them pretty quickly. It was probably about 2 months ago that I said I would do it. So it's been a whirlwind of making 10 gowns, but it's come along pretty well, I would say. So yeah.
I think it's important to highlight local talent because, you know, local designers, they're artists, right? Like, and if we hear this about artists all the time, starving artists, but it's only that because they don't know the resources, they don't know where to start. So creating a platform where they can actually come together with a community of like-minded individuals, they can get the resources that maybe they didn't know were accessible to them. So what we do is create a stage for that emerging talent to know where to go next and how to elevate each time that they do.
I feel like the platform's huge because there's not a lot of fashion going on in Denver in this kind of realm. A lot of people are trying to start runway shows, but really Denver Fashion Week is the first one that actually did one and has done it pretty well and has gotten a lot of people to it. So I feel like for designers, it's kind of like your moment for a Denver fashion in general. To like actually show what you have. A lot of people get to see your designs, I feel like, ever since a lot of the pictures are on the pamphlets and on their Instagram and things like that. A lot of people have reached out to me about my designs. So that's been like a great way for me to be able to talk to people about that and kind of show more of my designs that people usually wouldn't see. But everyone's been so nice and really welcoming, which has been really awesome. And all the models are so great and really excited. I'm really happy to see it all come together.
So inclusivity is actually the center of Denver Fashion Week. So what we offer to models is a fully inclusive platform that we have, you know, models from all creeds, all colors, all heights, all sizes. We do not cast based on anything other than confidence and conviction. So really, if you think it, it's pretty possible. So if you want to come out and model, like, we just tell anyone and everyone that you can have that chance and that opportunity. So our nonprofit this year is Dress for Success Denver, and they're actually very on par with supporting women get professional attire and support for going on job interviews or honestly just going out in the workforce. It's kind of like sometimes, again, right, we don't know what resources we have or what to do with those resources. So to be able to have someone to go to, it's such a huge thing, especially, you know, when you go to a job interview and you have a brand new jacket or a brand new shirt, it does something mentally to you. It's not just fashion, right? So I think that Dress for Success Denver is an amazing partnership for a nonprofit this season. If you've never been to a Denver Fashion Week runway experience, expect to be excited, because honestly, every single night is centered around a different theme because it's for everyone, right? We have all the way kids shows, streetwear, couture, so really it could be something brand new to you that maybe you're just like, I just want to try this night. But I definitely think originality, excitement, creativity, and community. I think that especially after the past few years, community is such a huge thing that we've all been lacking. And I want to speak for everyone when I say I'm very excited to bring these creatives together again and be able to have us back on the runway doing what we love.
An overcast sky, heavy fog, and falling snow could not dampen the raised spirits of students, Denver City officials, and tribal representatives from Wyoming, Oklahoma, and Colorado gathered in Genesee Park.
Buffalo Tatanka. That's how you say it in Lakota. They're wild, they're free, they roam, they like to roam in herds. Like how Native Americans, they used to be like roam in groups and they used to follow the buffalo. That's why we were called the buffalo people. Yeah, so we're singing here today, singing to them and calming them down to hear their roots, I guess, their instincts of being indigenous and everything. And we're here to help them, and we're gifting the buffalo to the reservations where they can be over there and roam free and give back to the people and give back to Mother Earth.
On Monday, March 21st, Denver donated 33 young snorting bison to members of the Arapaho and Cheyenne tribes in an effort to restore the iconic animals to their tribal lands.
In 2020, I ran the ordinance that established a land acknowledgement for Denver City Council. And it's just something that reminds us of where we are and who came before us, and moreover, what our responsibility is to honor and recognize that. And so that's a nod to our Indigenous ancestors and those who lived in Denver and Colorado before it was Denver. And today, what results is we're in the second year of a bison donation program, which was inspired by that land acknowledgement, because it inspired Parks and Recreation to say, we don't have to be auctioning off bison. We should be donating them to Indigenous tribes who are reestablishing their herds around the country. And so that's what we worked on together last year.
To read words that are on a paper, the land acknowledgement, doesn't mean a lot until you really take action. And so the bison, the buffalo, are part of the land. So for us to be able to transfer these bison back to tribes across the nation to help them either improve their herd health or to actually start new herds is pretty amazing work that we're able to do.
So our goal with this is to try to increase sustainability and genetic diversity among conservation herds across the country, specifically focusing on tribal herds and supporting the efforts of tribes to restore bison to their lands.
A lot of times we talk about things, and this is actually putting action to them, and to see how thankful the nations were, the tribal nations were, was just once in a lifetime opportunity. Honestly, I've never seen anything like this happen on Parks land, and it was heart-wrenching and just heartwarming.
The Intertribal Buffalo Council, dedicated to restoring buffalo to reservations, has returned about 20,000 bison. Some are used for meat, some for ceremonies, some for economic development. But for many, simply sharing the land again with animals they consider sacred is satisfaction enough.
The significance of these ceremonial things goes back to the heart of who we are and our creation stories, what the buffalo means to us in our creation stories. And as our lives are nurtured by their very existence and their wanahi or spirit remains strong with us, and we will hold them sacred truly throughout our lives.
This is what we should have been doing for decades as owners and as stewards of these wonderful animals, returning them as we have nurtured them and raised them, but returning them back to our indigenous leaders of this land, the caretakers of this land. These are, as pointed out, your spiritual animals.
It was important for me to be here to not only welcome the bison, but also to help journeying them back to the reservation. Today, we're gonna have a ceremony back home with them as well. And it's just gonna be welcoming, and it's just exciting for the youth and everybody to be a part of this.
As the animals were brought to the transport trailers, their hooves echoed like thunder across the park. A circle of young men pounded drums and raised their voices in honor of the bison. One woman spoke indigenous words of comfort to ease the beasts in preparation for the journey home.
I am as I am looking at me. This is her.
Fentanyl, this is a fairly new term. This is not something that we've been talking about historically, like heroin, for example. Fentanyl is a synthetic drug, meaning it was created in a laboratory and is 50 times more powerful than heroin. This is not something that is specific to one group, one demographic, one neighborhood. This is something that is impacting people across the spectrum, folks of different socioeconomic classes, folks from urban environments, from suburban environments, from rural environments. And when you're talking about a drug that's highly addictive, that is causing overdose deaths, it is important that everybody start to get this term in their lexicon so we can start talking about ways to address it. Our understanding is that the raw material, the raw fentanyl itself, is primarily coming from China. It's then being packaged in Mexico and then making its way throughout the United States. That's the primary source. We are aware of areas within the country that are seeing some of the pure forms, and so it doesn't necessarily take the exact same path, but what we can say is this is a very deadly substance. It's arguably the most deadly illegal drug that we've had to deal with. However, this is an approach that drug dealers are utilizing. To them, it's advantageous to put fentanyl in different substances in order to sell more product in the future. High potency that is very addictive brings repeat customers to enhance their profits. And unfortunately, more and more drugs are being laced with fentanyl, and it is such a deadly substance that one too many micrograms can cause death. We're seeing far too many overdose deaths, and it's important that we not look at this as numbers or statistics, that we look at this as individual people who have families and the devastation that's taking place because of this drug. And that is one critical component that we cannot lose sight of. People are losing their life, families are being destroyed as a result of it. on the other side of the equation, or the other side of this issue, we are seeing more and more violence as well. Many of these high-level cases, we are getting ghost guns, we're getting semi-automatic weapons, we're getting assault-style rifles on these particular cases. So it speaks to the other aspect of this and the violence that's involved, the violence over drug turf and being able to sell this poison that is causing death on our streets. Now, what the Denver Police Department and our partners, both state partners and federal partners, are doing is primarily targeting the high-level drug dealers. We are taking off individuals that have 10,000 pills, 20,000 pills, 100,000 pills, and that's great. Areas of concern or areas that are more difficult is the low and mid-level dealers that we are seeing currently that are contributing to this overdose death epidemic. And we need every tool, we need every partner, we need federal, state, local efforts, we need public health efforts, we need nonprofits, we need service providers to include treatment areas to come together to figure out solutions, because these overdose deaths are skyrocketing, and we can't look at them just as that statistic. We have to look at them as individual people who are no longer with us. We have to look at them as families that have been destroyed by this illegal substance, and bring awareness to the issue so that way we can collectively try to tackle this problem. This is likely to be the crisis of the future. The pandemic has hidden this epidemic of fentanyl that is creating these deaths at alarming rates throughout our community, and it does not appear that things are stabilizing. It does not appear that these deaths are leveling off. It appears that they continue to go up and up and up. And each one of those cases is somebody's life, it's somebody's family that has been negatively impacted as a result.
Denver's Department of Climate Action, Sustainability, and Resiliency is working hard to ensure a climate-safe future by helping the city meet its goal of reducing greenhouse gas emissions completely by 2040. Certifiably Green Denver, or CGD, is designed to assist in achieving these goals by helping businesses reduce their environmental impact and become more energy efficient and less wasteful, all at no cost to the business itself. Almost 2,000 businesses of all sizes and shapes have benefited from the program.
My name is William Polidori Harris. I am fifth generation Polidori, going on 97 years in business here. Five generations ago, came here to North Denver, started making sausage, you know, kind of had this family recipe that kind of snowballed into making its way into grocery stores and eventually growing to the company that we are today. Sustainability is something we pride ourselves around here, so it felt like the right thing to do. We reached out to Certifiably Green Denver. We were like, hey, how do we get the ball rolling on this? So they worked with us, helped us, you know, check those criteria boxes off, and we became Certifiably Green Denver.
I'm Kathleen Cronin. I'm the executive director of Earthlinks. Earthlinks was started to connect people and bring people out from their isolation, reconnect folks that are homeless into the mainstream community, and to allow people to move forward and get stabilized in their lives. We have a very high success rate on moving people from being unhoused to housed, about 70% per year. Earthlinks, as part of its mission, is to care for Earth. That is the main thing we feel connects everyone together, is to care for our common planet Earth. And so for many years, we've tried to be as green as we possibly can. And we found out about this program, so we decided to apply, and it's been very helpful to us, so we're grateful.
The program works in several ways. First, a team of experts will help a business create a plan to achieve sustainability goals at their own pace, including how to be more energy efficient and conservative with water use. The big step in the program comes from being fully certified. To achieve this, businesses must complete a list of criteria in five different categories designed to improve efficiency across all areas of the business.
Put the LED lights around our facility where applicable. So with our six main freezers, the energy compressors, we've modified to make them efficient. We work with a local company, Scraps, to compost any leftover meat. We're moving towards bike racks. We currently provide all of our employees with RTD bus passes.
And then it has allowed us to be able to say, you know, maybe we're not so good in this one area and we could do some improvements. So we've improved some of our composting techniques, and we've also looked at some of the things that happened in the garden in terms of stormwater or drainage water to make sure that we're doing that properly.
The benefits of the program are many. The CGD staff can connect you to rebates, financial incentives, and partners to help meet your goals. Plus, it's free. And the staff will be with you the whole way.
They're super helpful, you know, if we ever, you know, have troubles coming up with new ideas to implement to be sustainable in within our own company, you know, they always have new, fresh ideas.
The CGD staff is also working to push out funding to ensure equity across the program by providing an increase in services and supplies to help small, minority, and women-owned businesses achieve their sustainability goals. There's also financial benefits to running an energy-efficient business.
The low-flush toilets and the sinks that we have, we've seen water bills go down, you know, with the energy-efficient lights. We've seen our energy bills go down, so those are just kind of a lot of the great things we've seen come out of the program.
And the benefits after certification are even greater. CGD certification comes with free advertising promoting the certified business, as well as a decal to affix to their front door. This helps like-minded customers and other businesses connect with these green operations.
Well, the certification itself is wonderful. I think the real piece would be that we could also join with other folks in Denver that are trying to move towards a greener Denver. And so in that sense, the collaboration opportunities for us with other businesses and entities will be very important to us as we move forward.
We encourage all of our vendors and all of our customers to do so. One of our spice companies that we purchased our spices through, Rocky Mountain Spice, they actually became certifiably Green Denver after we, you know, kind of encouraged them to. So they kind of followed in our footsteps in that aspect.
If you have a business that's interested in becoming more sustainable and help the city achieve its climate goals, go to certifiablygreendenver.org to get started.
I think it's just important that people know about us, but also know that maybe some of these things anyone can do. And we really all have to work together to bring us into the climate goals that the city has. It's very important for the city to be a leader in this area.
People take trees for granted. They sometimes think that they will always be here.
Trees are a precious resource. They give us shade, clean our air, sequester carbon, and help retain water. Plus, they just look really good, right? They are a constant and welcome presence in our lives. But if we're not careful, we could lose them. That's where the City Forester's Office comes in. These dedicated individuals speak for the trees and work year-round to maintain, protect, and replenish our forest here in the city and county.
These old mature trees, you can't replace them. So if we were to lose some of these trees, then it's going to take decades and up to a century to replace some of these trees that have been here for quite some time.
So we try to keep the trees healthy, resilient, right?
They're responsible for the care of around 225,000 trees in our parks and public rights of way.
Behind me, we've got one of our forestry maintenance crews out pruning one of our American elm trees, and then tree removals as trees die, we remove those year-round. And then planting, we basically have two main planting seasons, so spring and fall. Citywide, we plant about 3,000 trees roughly every year.
Denver's trees are defined as an urban forest because they exist within a man-made environment. Working in an urban forest presents a tall task for both the trees and the foresters.
There's just other obstacles, other things that these trees in an urban forest has to kind of deal with. I mean, like a road, like pollution, vandalism in the parks. I mean, they're just social things that trees are in our urban forests have to deal with.
And then a lot of it, you know, just citywide is some of the urban development. You know, we've got new buildings that are going up, new homes, and lots of times trees get sacrificed. So, you know, we're really pushing to try to protect those trees during construction projects. And then also just the climate change, you know, temperature fluctuations we had, pretty hard freezes that have, you know, killed fairly mature trees. And then, you know, these heavy wet snows that come through, drop large limbs and sometimes whole trees. So It's definitely a challenging place to try to grow trees.
There are also pests that are threats as well, such as the emerald ash borer.
So emerald ash borer is a small emerald green insect. So there's a little larva that tunnel underneath the bark, and it'll basically kill the tree within 3 or 4 years, typically. What's interesting about EAB is it'll attack healthy trees versus a lot of other insects prey on the stress trees, the drought stress trees and things of that nature. But emerald ash borer will go after a perfectly healthy tree, and so that's why it's such a detriment to our urban forest and a threat.
1 in 6 trees in Denver is an ash tree. Denver Parks and Rec's Be a Smart Ash campaign has resources to help you identify if you have an ash tree and what to do if you have one in your yard. There are also programs to grow our forests in our neighborhoods. The Forestry Neighborhood Initiative works with residents in underserved neighborhoods to identify and remove any hazardous trees in the public right-of-way and replace them with new trees, all at no cost to the homeowners. 208 trees were planted during 2021 under this initiative. There's also the Free Trees program that allows any resident in the city to apply for a free tree to be planted in a public right-of-way. 10,000 trees have found their way into Denver's soil since the program began. Another urban forest enhancement project will come alongside the 16th Street Mall redesign project. An additional 76 trees will be added to the current canopy along the mall. The trees will be a mixture of the current honey locusts as well as a slew of others to increase diversity.
But I think what's really cool is what's happening underneath the sidewalk. We're really trying our best to create more soil volume, so that will just give the trees more chance to grow, the roots to grow, which in turn should give us a more vigorous urban forest. To me, that's the coolest part of the whole project.
The foresters have also been branching out for the past 15 years, experimenting with what trees will grow in Denver, including some with lofty expectations.
It was just kind of on a whim. We started planting trees, exotic, non-native trees here in Vanderbilt Park. So I'm going to say 30 species of trees we have in this park. So behind me is a giant sequoia. Off to my left is a bald cypress. A bald cypress is a swamp tree, right? We're in semi-arid Colorado. Those things shouldn't grow here, and we've had really good luck with them.
So don't miss your chance to see a giant sequoia right in your own backyard. And don't miss your chance to help replenish our urban forest when Parks and Rec holds their annual Arbor Day event in May.
This year it's going to be May 15th, and we're going to be planting about 150 trees out in the Northfield area. So we've got 4 different parks out there that are fairly new parks, but some of the new trees did not survive. So we're going to be replanting a lot of those trees out there.
And make sure to thank our foresters for helping keep our forest healthy and resilient. Stay elevated by subscribing to the city's YouTube page for these stories and more. And stay tuned to our social media channels for more content. Don't miss our new episodes of Elevating Denver, premiering each month. Thanks for watching, Denver.